Welcome back to my video series investigating the ARM Cortex M33 core and the ARM Trustzone extension. This is the ninth video in the series, and this week we're continuing to look at Trustzone. And this time we're looking at Trustzone in practice. How does Trustzone help us with the Heartbleed security exploit? There's a wide range of material on the internet describing Heartbleed, so let's just take 2 minutes to understand Heartbleed and what it means for us as embedded designers. Heartbleed was a very widely publicized security vulnerability in the Heartbeat extension to the TLS protocol in OpenSSL. Disclosed in April 2014, the bug allowed data to be read over TLS, potentially disclosing valuable security material. OpenSSL is widely adopted in internet applications, and this vulnerability had a potential global impact. TLS and DTLS protocols are used for secure IP communication channels. The Heartbleed extension was introduced in 2012 in RFC 6520 as a method to keep alive a secure communication link. Typically, a client will send a Heartbleed message to the server to prevent the need to renegotiate the secure connection. The Heartbleed extension defines that a short message is sent over the link, formatted as a string and the number of characters in the string. The other end of the link, the server in this example, replies with the same string, maintaining the link. Importantly, the implementation of Heartbleed in OpenSSL 1.0.1 did not test the string length and would respond with the requested number of characters. When the number of characters exceeded the string length, this missing bounds check allowed the host to send the requested number of bytes from memory, potentially disclosing security material from the host. The proposed Heartbleed exploit would reverse engineer this data, potentially disclosing session keys or even private server-side keys. OpenSSL was fixed in April 2014, on the day that Heartbleed was disclosed, in version 1.0.1g. And note that the embed TLS middleware in MCU Expresso SDK for the LPC55S69 EVK does not support the Heartbleed extension and was not and is not susceptible to Heartbleed. I've created a project inside MCU Expresso to simulate Heartbleed. The project is based on the shell example project from the SDK, and I've modified it to add an extra function. I've created a new command named beat. We can see the registration of this function just here in line 212. And what it enables me to do is through the command interface to call the function beat and pass in a string and a string length. The purpose of the function is to change the string into uppercase and reply it back to me. So let's see that in operation. I have my LPC55S69 evaluation kit plugged into my computer, and I'm now going to build the code and start a debug session. Build it using the quick start panel, and that's done. Let me download that to the board. Now it's a shell example, and so we're going to use the terminal to interface to the project. And this time I'm going to use the terminal that's built into MCU Expresso. Let me just add that to my project. I can do that from the window menu, which is just off screen. And I'm going to show a view named terminal. Here it is. Select it and open it in the project. Here's my terminal window. Of course, just like any terminal emulator, I have to connect it to the COM port that I'm using. I can use this button here to configure that. And it's going to be a serial terminal. I'm using my Mac today, and the Mac has evaluated this particular USB modem. That's the COM port from the LPC55S69 EVK. As always, 115-200 board 8N1. So we can say OK. OK, let me run the project and we'll see the prompts come up from shell in this TerraTerm window. So let's run. And here we are with our host interface to our project. As I mentioned, I've created a new function called beat, and this enables me to pass a string into the function. The function will convert it to uppercase and will repeat it back to the screen. The example works like this. I simply type beat, which is the command, and then pass in a string, hello, and the number of characters. The string's passed into the function, it's converted to uppercase and is sent back to me. I enter hello, lowercase. The server responds in green with the uppercase string. Let's try that one more time. We pass in world, and the server responds with world. And this is simulating Heartbleed, where we'll send in a Heartbleed message. It's just a string in clear text, and the server at the far end running OpenSSL is going to respond with the string, just as a keep alive over the network. Well, as you noticed, we have a number of characters that we want to convert. So if I type in a longer message, and then a number for the number of characters I want to convert, let's convert 7 characters. And you can see that the string has been terminated to be 7 characters. Well, this is dangerous because the project has got a string length that we want to convert. It could be any positive integer, so let's pass in another one. Let's pass in 3. The string's getting terminated to 3 characters. But the question comes about, what happens if we pass in a string length which is longer than the string that we pass in? What happens? Well, let's try this again with a different number. And let's pass in 10. Maybe we get 10 characters out. We get this warning message, length is greater than the string length. Okay, well, I'm now going to look at another version of the code. Well, we don't make these tests, and this is effectively what happened with the Heartbleed OpenSSL bug. So let me return to the editing window just by closing this debug session. I'm going to edit the code now and remove the test where we looked at the length of the string. When we rebuild the code, we'll find that we can point past the end of the string when we use the beat function. Well, I've now rewritten my beat function, and I've written it deliberately badly. It doesn't test the string length that we pass in, and it doesn't test for the number of characters that we pass in. And I'm expecting that we can create a buffer overrun so that when we print the uppercased string, that it will go into memory past the end of the string. It's best to see that in action. So let me build the project. The code compiles is just badly written code, and let me start a debug session. MCU Expresso IDE will remember that I had the terminal window available, and so we can just run the project and watch what happens in the terminal. Here it is with the project loaded into Flash and into the debugger, and let me run my code. The code is running, and here we are in our command line interface. So again, let me test it with the beat instruction, and let me send in a sensible string. Okay, this behaves exactly as we saw before. If I do it again and pass in a parameter that's smaller than the string length, I send in 3. It's all behaving exactly as I would expect. But let's test the case where the number of characters to return is greater than the string length. So I will send in a message. And this time, that's 10, 11 characters. Let me ask for 32 characters back. So the question is, where is that repeated server string coming from? What I'm going to do is do one final test and ask for a much larger buffer this time. So we are going to enter beat and just send in a string, just the characters on my keyboard. And this time we're going to ask for more characters. And we can start to see the behavior now. We're getting what appears to be garbage string, but this is actually data that's going to be in the stack on the chip. And this information might be revealing information about what the processor has been up to. And in the case of Heartbleed, it might contain valuable security information. I'm just going to pause my code. And I'm going to look in the memory window, and I know that the string which I'm using is at this address 20,400,000. It's just part of the stack on the chip. And we can see that in this particular example, we asked for 64 bytes, and the beat function has just returned the 64 bytes that we asked for. This goes up into this data that's been stored on the stack. And in the case of Heartbleed, this information might be valuable to a bad actor who's trying to take advantage of the Heartbleed bug. Good, that's done. Let me stop the example and go back to the edit window. I'm going to close the project as always. I'm sorry to break the bad news to you, but Trustzone does not help us with an issue like Heartbleed. Maybe it's unexpected, but Heartbleed wins. Trustzone is an important platform when we need to partition our code into a secure and a non-secure state. All of the Trustzone features that police the entry into and exit from secure functions can be absolutely trusted. And while Trustzone can be relied upon, it cannot police our bad software. And so through a programming error, if you pass the secure world an invalid pointer or an invalid memory block, then the core will simply process it, just like any other pointer allocation. It's the job of the professional software engineer to write professional software. And whilst Trustzone tests function entry and exit, and the CSME standard will zero out the core registers on exit from a function, it's up to the software engineer to check the input parameters to a function. We have to test the input parameters to a function. And so, for example, is the pointer in non-secure memory? ARMP have implemented the test target TT instruction that for any address will return the region number that's allocated in the SAU, the secure attribution unit. And from the region number, we'll know whether it's secure, non-secure, or non-secure callable memory. Another consideration would be, is the input string null terminated? Or will the input structure fit into the memory that's been allocated for it from the secure state? These are fundamental programming considerations. And if you're building an IoT application that absolutely must have security, and you select the Cortex M33 core with the Trustzone extension, then also make sure that you have a professional software environment. Make time for code reviews. Look for opportunities to improve the reliability of your software without relying on Trustzone to provide it for you. And so, in my opinion, the final result is Heartbleed wins. However, Trustzone also wins, provided it's used in a responsible manner with professional software standards. That's it for this week. Next week, I'm going to move away from Trustzone and look at some more features of the LPC55S69. I hope to see you then. Goodbye.